want you to think back to your Calc 2 class. And you were asked to find the antiderivative of e to the x sine x. Remember this problem? You can do integration by parts. You do with that guy? So you do an integration by parts again, this time u equals cosine x, and then you substitute it back in. It looks like you're going in circles, but you boomerang around, and then you can do a trick. Remember all that?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the calculus way of doing it. But what's a much better branch of mathematics that would give an even easier solution? Linear algebra. Absolutely right. Boo Calc 2. We're going to do this one the linear algebra way. Chapter 4 is there's lots of things besides vectors that act a lot like vectors. So what do we do with vectors? Is if you give me two vectors, if you give me a vector, I can stretch it and make it longer. And if you give me two vectors, I can add them together to make another vector. So do you see that also works with polynomials? If I have two polynomials and add them together, it's another polynomial. And if I multiply a polynomial by a scalar, it's still a polynomial. Or if I have two matrices, I can add two matrices together to make a new matrix. I can do a matrix times a scalar, and that's still a matrix. So polynomials can be vectors, matrices can be vectors, and in general, I'm going to think about functions as vectors. So my space is all the functions, and I'm going to make a subspace, describe it by a basis, and here's my basis. So the basis is the building blocks. And then some things in W are everything that we can make as a combination of these basis elements. Basis elements are going to be my space of W. I said, okay, so my space is all the functions. I'm going to look at all the functions that look like this. And then, I can describe elements of W as coordinates. Talked about this in the last section. Let's call this basis B. So here is an element of W. And everything in W can be built as a linear combination of basis elements. So everything in W can be built by scaling this first vector, scaling this second vector, and adding the two scaled vectors together. What coordinates do is they just give you the scaling factors. So when I say, even if I didn't tell you this part, let's try this one. If I tell you the coordinates are 2, 3, what coordinates mean is what I'm trying to build here is two copies of the first basis element plus three copies of the second basis element. So what goes here? What's the thing in B that has these coordinates? So here's what's interesting. E to the x cosine x is in W. And if I take the derivative of that is going to be in W as well. So what's the derivative of e to the x cosine x?
X cosine x minus c to the x sine x.
Perfect. Good. And is the derivative of e to the x sine x in W? So if I take this basis element and I take its derivative, is it still in W? So this would be e to the x cosine x plus e to the x sine x. So what's interesting about my space W is if I pick anything inside W and take its derivative, it's going to stay inside W. Okay, now I want you to think about these as the coordinates. So e to the x cosine x, what are the coordinates? So if you're going to build this function out of these two elements, yeah, how many of these do you need? How many of those do you need? And then for this output, what would the coordinates of this output be? X sine x. So what are the coordinates? How many of these?
Zero.
How many of those?
One.
0 to 1 goes to 1, 1. Do these 1, 0, and 0, 1 look familiar?
First and second column.
These are the first and second columns. So what I can do is I can represent taking a derivative by applying a matrix to a coordinate vector. Remember that I can build a matrix a column at a time. So the first column of the matrix for finding derivatives is 1, -1. So the derivative matrix is 1, -1, 1. Thank you. this might be a typical Calc 1 problem. Y is 2 e to the x cosine x plus 3 e to the x sine x. You can do it the Calc 1 way. But the linear algebra way of solving this is, what are the coordinates of the y function? And in linear algebra, converting vector to vector is done by multiplying by a matrix. And you're all experts at multiplying. And what goes here?
Five.
And then convert it back. So y prime, what does this 5 represent?
Cosine.
And what does the 1 represent?
5.
So instead of working with the function directly, we work with the coordinates. And the coordinates form a vector. And doing a calculus problem, finding the derivative, is converting vector to vector. In linear algebra, we learned that the rule for converting vector to vector can be described as a matrix multiplication. So again, the linear algebra way of finding the derivative is to just multiply by this matrix. And here's the interesting thing, though.
Are those standard basis?
For MySpace. So I made that up. MySpace is. What's the second thing you do in calculus?
So
first part, yeah, integrals. And what's the relationship between a derivative and an integral? They're inverses of each other, right? So the way an integral works is I tell you what the derivative is, and you have to go back to the original space. So how are we going to do that with the matrix? How are we going to do the backwards problem with
inverse.
The matrix? The inverse, exactly. So the integral matrix. The inverse of this, and that's 1 over the crisscross, switch those. I think I lost it. I did sine, right? So that's the problem that we started with, which you did in your Calc 1. I'm going to convert this e to the x sine x into a vector. So what's that vector?
1, 0.
Plus
0,
1. Good. Yeah, so remember my basis came in this order. So it's 0 cosines and 1 sine. And so if we think about not this function directly, but its code or its coordinates. Its coordinates are a vector and an integral. And if we need to convert it into another vector. That's actually an easy one. You can do that in your head. What is it? So any matrix times any matrix times 0, 1 just extracts the second column. And then convert this back into the original space. What's the function? Negative 1 half e to the x cosine x plus 1 half e to the x sine x. And then I'm just going to add this and just mention where this comes from in linear algebra. We'll talk about it later. What am I missing? As a Calc 2 teacher, I'm marking wrong.
I'll see.
So when we do it this way, we just have to add that. But about briefly where that plus c comes from is imagine that I'm thinking about functions as vectors, and I have a transformation which goes from functions to functions, where that transformation is to take the derivative. What's the kernel of this function? What's the definition of kernel?
Output is on zero.
Yeah, all the inputs whose output is zero. So what are the functions whose derivative is zero? Constants. First degree is. So the kernel of this is the constant functions, which is exactly where this plus C is coming from. If we have time, we can talk a bit more about that. So do you agree that finding this integral by doing matrix times a vector is much easier than roll u and dv twice and boomerang around? Yay, we need help. So your 3 out of 21 pre-engineering units you take. This is going to be what you care about. Okay, so. Understand what I just did here? This is pretty much all of chapter 4. Chapter 4 is building up what we can do here. Let's call this 4.1. So everybody on the entire planet, except for your book's author, calls these vector spaces. Your book calls these linear spaces. And so the idea of a vector space things. So if you've got a collection of objects and these two things are true about that collection of objects, then you can consider them, you can treat them like vectors. Let's think about 2x2 matrices. Does it make sense to add 2 2x2 matrices together? It would have to be 6, 12, 21, 21. Hey, does that a 2x2 matrix? Okay. So in this case, if I'm thinking about 2x2 matrices as vectors, vector plus vector is a vector. And if I did 5 times 1, 2, 3, 4, if I work that out, what do I get?
5, 10, 15, 20.
Is k times vector equal to a vector? Okay. So I can consider all 2x2 matrices as a vector space. Technically, they're not vectors, but they behave just like vectors. And this is a famous enough vector space that it gets a name. We write it like this, R 2x2. That R indicates that the numbers are coming. We've got real numbers as entries, and it's 2x2. Famous vector spaces have standard bases. Standard basis for R 2x2 is that. what letter do we use for standard bases? So script S will always mean standard basis. Different spaces have different standard bases. So for R 2x2, these are the building blocks to build any matrix, and that's the order we want them. So just so we're clear about this, so I'm going to give you an object in my space. So I give you a 2x2 matrix. And then to say this is a basis means I can build anything in the space out of these basis elements. It's what I want here are the instructions for building this particular base, this particular matrix out of these basis elements. So in other words, first thing I want you to do is tell me for each basis element how many copies of that do I need for my 5, 6, 7, 8. A standard basis always makes this easy calculation. How many of these? How many of these? How many of these? Coordinates are a vector. The real idea is if I have this abstract space and a basis, I can turn it, I can take every object, turn it into a vector, and then do all the linear algebra I know about the vectors. So it's 5, 6, 7. So here's an object in the space. Given that this is a basis for the space, that means that my particular object can be written as a linear combination of these basis elements. For this example, the scalars are 5, 6, 7, and 8. So the coordinates of this object relative to this basis are 5, 6, 7, 8. And the key idea, yeah?
So what basis is the original A in? With the other ones, the standard?
Oh no, A is just an object.
Okay.
And to say that this is a basis means that everything can be written as a combination of basis elements. Okay. Is that okay?
Yeah, A seems to be floating in the void. I want it to be attached to something like a basis.
Oh no, it's, yeah, let's back up. Sorry.
Don't back up too far, it's just me.
Yeah, that's cool. No,
okay.
So I think about R2,
yeah.
And my mental picture is all the vectors that are on this plane. The standard basis for R2 is this. And so what that means is if you give me anything in R2, like 3, 7, here's a generic 3, 7 object, is I can build this out of these basis elements. So these are enough to build anything in R2. So just like this 3, 7 is floating around somewhere in R2, it's built out of these guys. Is that cool? So this guy is just one of many 2x2 matrices. And it can be built out of these four basis
elements. Or other bases.
Yeah, exactly. And then, yeah, we're going to find that sometimes there's going to be better coordinate systems or better bases for the problem. But for the standard basis, that's what we use.
Yeah.
And questions are good. So far, so good? Of degree 2. polynomial of degree two and add to it a polynomial of degree two, is that going to be a polynomial of degree two? And if I take a polynomial of degree two, and multiply that by a scalar, is that going to be a polynomial of degree two? And then there's one thing we have to be careful of.
When this worked, when you add them together, the polynomials would go down to degree one.
Let's do good.
Exactly.
So what if I add this degree two polynomial plus this degree two polynomial? What do I get? Degree two polynomial? The actual space is polynomials of degree less than or equal to two. Is that going to work? Oh, just like I was saying, this is an 8. That's what I said. So technically, polynomials of degree 2 don't form a vector space. Because remember, for vector space, we need vector plus vector to be vector. Polynomial of degree 2 plus polynomial of degree 2 is not polynomial of degree 2. But if I change my definition slightly, I can make it work. So this is important enough to get its own name. We call it P sub 2. Standard basis for P sub 2 is 1x and x squared. And you have to be careful, is order matters for the basis. When we're talking about coordinates or the building blocks, this number represents how many copies of the first thing we need. So you have to know what the first one is. So the standard basis for P2 starts. Coordinates of this polynomial relative to this basis. And if I was going to write this given polynomial as a linear combination of those basis elements, how many 1s do I need, how many x's do I need, and how many x squareds do I need? I want to make sure that you've got the negative 2 here first. So let's talk about this. So to find the coordinates means I want to figure out how much I have to scale each basis element by. And I want to make sure that I write these down in the same order they're given to be here. So how many copies of 1 do I need to go to 1 on the left? how many x's and how many x squareds. So that vector is going to be negative 2. We're going to try to use as many words as we can, as many earlier words. What does dimension mean? What's the definition of dimension? Number of vectors. In the basis. So the dimension is the number of vectors in the basis. What's the dimension of P2?
3.
And remember my basis for R 2 by 2. This. What's the dimension of R2 by 2?
4.
Is there a reason they decided the standard basis for P2 was that?
Yes.
Not backwards?
Yes.
Okay.
So the standard basis for P1, actually we'll make it P3, is you've got the basis for P2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, oh, I see. Going up degree is just acting right. Words are going to apply. What does subspace mean? What's your metaphor or your intuition for a subspace? Yeah, it's a jail. So that means if I take two things where plugging in a one gives me a zero and add them together, it's going to have that property. So let's try it. Is give me an element of P2 so that when I plug in a one, I get zero. Or do I actually plug zero? Does that work? And give me another one. How about x squared minus 1? Does that work? And if I add these together, if I plug a 1 into this, do I still get a 0? So remember how subspaces work? It's like the jail. I pick two things that are in jail. It's the first one satisfies this property. The second one satisfies that property. And when I add them together, the sum satisfies the property. Let's try. X squared plus 3 of x minus 4. And then I do 2 times x squared plus x minus 4. So notice if I plug 1 into this, I get 0.
That's a 6.
Like I was saying, plus 6x minus 8. It takes a terrible day. If I plug a 1 into this, does it still work?
Mm-hmm.
So this, you should believe this is a subspace. If I pick two things that have this property and add them together, it still has this property. And if I pick something with that property and multiply by a scalar, it still has that property. What's our best way to describe a subspace?
A
basis. these problems all along. It's to find a basis for W, we're going to find a generic element of V. We're going to subject it to the conditions. And then we're going to have something in terms of parameters. We're going to make some functions. We're going to make some equations, parameterize the infinitely many solutions, and then pull the parameters out. So what is a generic object of V? P of x equals. So if I say describe the generic thing in P2, it's a polynomial degree 2 or less, something times x squared plus something times x plus something. So what's the mathematical description of what it means for that generic object to be in W? What has to happen?
X has to be 1,
2. Well, when x equals 1, we have to get 0. So to be in W, P of 1 is 0. So A times 1 squared plus B times 1 plus C is 0. Or in other words, A plus B plus C. Sometimes the equations are hard. This one, we've already got it. The coefficient of A is 1, since we have it reduced to row echelon form. C is a free choice. B is a free choice. And A is minus S minus T. Coming over here. So here's our generic object. Looks like ax squared plus bx plus c. And then in order to be in our space W, this has to be true. We can translate the condition into an equation. And then, we've been doing this since chapter 1, we can get a nice parameterization of the infinitely many solutions to this equation. So putting these two together, we get that P of x is minus x times T x squared. Let me write that here one more. A x squared plus B x C. Remember, we're trying to find a basis, we split it up by parameters. So I'm going to do all the parts with S first, and then all the parts with T. So far, so good? Factor those parameters out. So P is, as the property that I want, W is all the P's that are in this form. Another way to say this is is if P is in W, P can be written as a combination of these two polynomials. This is what I'm thinking myself. Can I build one of those vectors out of the other one? Could I multiply this by a scalar to get that? So, no redundancies there. So my basis for W is going to be negative x squared plus x and negative x squared plus y. A few more of these, but the idea is always the same. Is I'm going to give you some ambient space, so maybe P2 or R2 by 2. I'm going to describe a subspace, so some of those elements are going to be special to me. In this one, I like all the ones that produce. With an input of 1, give an output of 0. I can ask for a basis for that subspace, and I found it. Easy question. What's the dimension of W? Right. Dimension, how many elements in the basis? Is x squared plus x minus 2 in W?
Yes.
And when I put square braces subscript B, what does that mean?
In basis.
Yeah, find the coordinates.
Find the perspective. Yeah, basis.
In other words. I want you to think about this. I'm going to clean some stuff up over there, unless there's any objections. Just think about how I put the scalars here and here. And then those are going to be the coordinates. So this basis is nice enough that you should be able to put this in your head. When we get to chapter 5, we're going to talk about how some bases are nice, so you can just look at it and figure out the scalars, and some aren't so nice, it's a more complicated process to get those scalars. We'll talk about how to build nice bases. Okay, what I see here is that this basis element does not have an x, and this one does. So the only way that I can get the x here is to get it from this one. So how many x's do I have on the left?
One.
So this has to be a 1. And then this one only has x's. This one doesn't have a constant term. So the only constant term I have is right here. So that's got to be negative 2. And then just a quick sanity check. Negative 2 times negative x squared, that's 2x squared, minus an x squared, that matches this one. So the coordinates are 1 and negative 2. I got 1 Would that be an Insta? I didn't even know. Is Instagram? Would that go on an Instagram too?
Yeah,
that'd be more
there.
Okay. Check out my gram. I don't even know what those words mean.
Telegram.
So as soon as I write this, V equals R 2x2, what am I talking about? Yes, those are all 2x2 matrices.
Yeah.
Good. Do you know the standard basis? What does a generic object look like? Ambient space is the famous R 2x2. And then I want to look at the subspace, all the 2x2 matrices that have 1, 2 in the null space.
I was going to ask if this is a new example, right?
Yes. No problem. So I give you an ambient space, I describe a subspace in words. And then what's the problem going to be? What am I going to ask you to do? Is we're going to find a basis. So the best description of a subspace is with a basis. What are those basic building blocks that will describe everything in the space? So how do I do problems like this? Make a generic object. And then what do I do with that generic object? Is give a mathematical description of this. So what does it mean for 1, 2 to be in the null space of this matrix?
That matrix times 1, 2 equals the 0 vector.
Perfect. If this guy is actually in W, then the matrix times 1, 2 has to be the 0 vector. That's your definition. And then the idea is, I'm going to turn that into a system of equations, parameterize the infinitely many solutions of those equations, plug back in here, flat into my generic object, and split up my parameter. So far, so good? So work this out for me.
A minus 2b.
Or
A plus 2b.
Bottom line?
A plus 2.
So what has to happen? Is A plus 2b has to be 0. And C plus 2d has to be 0. D is a free choice. C is negative 2t. B is a free choice. Turn the condition into a system of equations. That system of equations has infinitely many solutions. We've been doing this since day one. We can parameterize those infinitely many solutions. Generic object looks like this, PBCB. And I just worked over there for my equations. A is negative 2s, B is s, C is negative 2t, and D is t. generic object. To be in a subspace, there's a hidden relationship among A, B, C, and D. The parameterization describes how they all have to be related to each other. What do I do now?
Find bases.
So what, that, what do I do with this guy?
Factor.
Right, right, exactly. So I'm going to write it. So this guy's going to be a linear combination of a couple of things. And to get that, I have to split it up by parameter. So I'm going to put all, keep all the S stuff together. And that's going to be away from all the T stuff. So I split this guy into an S part, into a T part. Just write this as a linear combination of those two. Putting this together, my space V is all 2x2 matrices. What's the dimension of V? And W is this interesting subspace. What's the dimension of the subspace? Then we can do coordinates. This in W. So I do a check. V and W, that means that 1, 2 has to be in its null space. So if I do this matrix times 1, 2, 0, 0. Yes. So let me call this base as B. Because what I want you to do is find the coordinates of this matrix relative. Say that this is a basis for W, that means any element of W can be written as a linear combination of those basis elements. How many of this one do I need?
-3.
second one do I need?
Negative one.
So I ask you for the coordinates of this guy relative to B. It's a two-dimensional subspace, so we're going to need a two-dimensional vector here. It's going to be -3, -1. One more? Are you guys okay with this? One more? Okay. So what does it mean for an integral to be zero? Yeah, in terms of area, I guess you're right.
Oh, okay, the area.
Yeah, so roughly, it's if I go from 0 to 1, the negative area and the positive area, they did balance each other out. Right? Okay. So that really is a subspace. Out of all the parabolas, all the degree 2 polynomials, there's a lot of them. I guess we could even go like this, where this negative area exactly matches that positive area. What do we want you to do? Is we're going to find a complete description of all the polynomials that have that property. By complete description, the linear algebra way of getting a complete description is with a basis. So all the parabolas, so that the negative area between 0 and 1 exactly matches the positive area between 0 and 1. So the process is the same. What's the first thing I do? Make a generic object. Give me a generic object in P2.
AX squared plus BX plus.
And then to be in W, there's the math condition. And you're going to turn that into a system of equations. How's your integration? Antiderivative of ax squared?
A over 3 x squared. B over 2 x squared plus cx.
If I was nice, I would have made the lower bound. Actually, no, I take it back. If the lower bound is 0, I think it does make this problem easier.
Yeah.
So when I plug in a 1, I get a over 3 plus b over 2
c
plus c. Good. And what happens when I plug 0 in for x?
0.
It's 0. matrix form, it looks like this. Is this in reduced row echelon form?
No.
That would need to be a 1. So multiply both sides of this equation by
3.
That's just going to make the parameterization a bit easier. I'm going to keep this part. In algebra, you just said there's infinitely many solutions, and you stop there. This class will describe them. Here's my generic object, and in order for this generic object to be in my subspace W, this has to be the relationship between the A's, the B's, and the C's. There's a free choice for C, a free choice for B, and then the A value is forced. So A is this, so plug it in, there's B. What do I do next?
Like terms.
Yeah, go like terms. So kind of by parameters. So it's negative 3 halves s x squared plus s times x plus. So I split it up by the parameters. And then factor the parameter out of each of those. You guys cool with that? So the first part is we describe the space, describe the subspace, describe the best description of a subspace as a basis. And the next thing we're going to do is look at transformations from space to space. And then every transformation can be written as a matrix. Now, in 4.2. soon as I write this, T is a transformation. In this case, the inputs are coming from P2, polynomials of degree 2 or less. Outputs are in P1, those are polynomials of degree 1 or less. Another way to say that is those are linear functions. And the rule is the P2 polynomial, the input is a degree 2 polynomial, the output is the derivative. So for example, I'm going to apply this transformation to that object. What's the output?
6x + 7.
Basis for P2, I'm going to use standard bases at this point. Later on, you might use non-standard bases. So my basis for P2 is 1xx². My basis for P1 is 1 and x. And I'll find the matrix for this transformation. So in other words, I want to translate this problem into something with coordinates. So 3x² + 7x - 5, what are the coordinates relative to the standard basis for P2?
-5, 7.
Glad that you did that in the right way. The order's important there. Remember, it's for P2, the standard description is constant, then x squared. Six x plus 7, the coordinates there. So describing this same data point, this input goes to that output. Describing it with coordinates is this vector goes to that vector. And in linear algebra, it's all our vector-to-vector transformations are done with matrices. So when I'm talking about finding the matrix for this transformation, and it's what I want you to do, is find a matrix. So that when -5, 7, 3 is the input, 7, 6 is the output. So first of all, what's the shape or the dimensions of the matrix on the left? How many columns? Remember,
3 by 3.
No, it could be a 2 by 3. Yeah, 2 by 3.
So first of all, does everybody agree 3 columns? Because remember that each of these gets hit by a column. Okay, but then the output is an R2 vector. So how many components do each of these have? 2. So this is going to have 3 columns and 2 rows. You've got the directions down. We're going to do the column at a time approach. How do we find column 1? What vector is going to extract column 1 for us? actually, it'd be 1, 0, 0, right? So those input factors look like this. Column 2. And column 3. Okay, 0, 0, 1 corresponds to what? Remember, this is an input.
X squared.
X squared. So 0, 0, 1 corresponds to x squared. And then, if I apply the t transformation to x squared, where does it go? 2x. And translate the 2x back. Actually, so this is in the output space. So how do I write 2x in the output space? Good. So the basis for the output is 1x. How many constants do you see? 0. How many x's?
2.
Find column 3, it's I have to figure out where 0, 0, 1 goes to. So I translate the input 0, 0, 1 into the actual object it is. 0 1s plus 0 x's plus 1 x squared. Then I apply the transformation. So the input is x squared, the output is 2x, I just took a derivative. And then I translate this into the coordinates for the output basis. And this 2x is 0 of these plus 2 of those. So what did I just find? So what does that 0, 2 represent?
The third column.
Right. So my answer. It's going to be over here. And what's the third column of my answer? Remember, this is our input. So to find column 2 of our matrix, is I use an input of 0, 1, 0. That's the same as x. Apply the t function to it. Good. So t is the function that takes the derivative of this. So that's 1. 1, 0. I like it. This whole process just found me what? Second column of the matrix I'm looking. Two-thirds of the way to the answer. What do I need to do? So how do I find the first column? 1, 0, 0. So you do it for me. Would anybody be sad if I erased this? So I'm going to erase. You're going to find column 1 for me. And 1, 0, 0 is the secret to finding column 1. So 1, 0, 0 refers to which P2 object?
One.
Yeah. constant function 1? What's the derivative of 1? Translate that back. So it just worked out that my first column to find the derivative of 3x squared plus 5x minus 2. I give you this matrix times. Translate this into its coordinates.
Negative 2, 5, 3.
Now it's a linear algebra problem. And then translate, here's the basis for translating the code of the answer to the real answer. What is it?
6 plus 5.
Go on. So that's our idea. The main idea for the chapter 4 is there's polynomials, matrices, lots of things can be considered vectors. Once we consider it like a vector, any transformation or any operation that changes one thing into another thing can be represented by a vector. So, see you on Wednesday.